a song, a number, a shape, a picture, a meaning, a code of verse mention, and that will give you the exact meaning and intent of the Creator to all his people. So now we see Yahshua, the Passover is that promise which is to come and which they ought to celebrate every year. The, as I call it, Easter, or this time, this replay of the Passover, which is when Christ proposed to his bride, and now he went on to his death, burial, and resurrection, which is a sacrifice. So now we see prior, he said, follow me. That word follow me, it doesn't only carry what we just said, that Greek word is diotech. It doesn't just carry that Greek word, that just follow me. And just like how most teachers today, when they're teaching this subject concerning Yahshua, concerning the Creator and mankind, they just say, God said it and that settled it, and you must what? You must just do it. Is that true? Is that the God of, now this is how they tend to relate to God, and they say the God of the Old Testament and the God of the New Testament is two different gods. Two different gods. That is what, and this is where you have a lot of confusion in reference to what is being communicated in reference to Torah, Tanakh, and what Yahshua actually revealed. Because remember, when we were talking about the men has two components, it, concealment and revelation. The concealment is in the Torah and the revelation is in the New Covenant or New Testament. So now look at something. Trust and relationship. Follow me. So now Christ is carrying out an action that he now is saying you ought to what? Follow. What action did he culminate on Good Friday? What action? He died. Did anyone kill Christ? Two schools of thought. They say the Jews killed Christ, and some of them say the Roman killed Christ. And the two of them put the blame on each other. However, when you look at this thing from a critical observation from scripture, and you look at what the text is literally saying in reference to the events, this historical event that took place in history. Now, these events are historical. How we know that? Mark, which is the oldest document, gospel that we know, which is written around AD 60, right? So we're looking at 30 years after the resurrection of Yahshua Mashiach. However, we know in the book of Corinthians 15, 1 Corinthians 15, I think so, yeah. 1 Corinthians 15, when you talk about, and Paul, he gave that which he have what? Received from those who were now practicing that of the event that took place at that particular point in time. And we know Paul was what? He was converted approximately 2 years after the what? The ascension of Yahshua. So we're looking at 2 years. If we look at the timeline, Yahshua, he resurrected here. Paul, he started his journey right here. But from here, from the time he resurrected, Paul start his journey from the time he resurrected to here, which is 2 years, from here to here, 2 years, and he was doing what? What Paul was doing? He was killing the people, the Jews that were worshiping, or that now bring clarity to all that which was written in scripture. Those who are now what? Following after who? Mashiach, right? So we know, and Stephen, who literally reenact that event. And what Stephen said while they were stoning him? Late not to their charge, just like Yahshua. So now we're seeing, now Stephen is following in that same what? Footstep like Yahshua. He was Yalak. He was now, Yalak is the Hebrew word to walk. Yalak. Mean he is now carrying out that same step. Now he's stepping in whose step? In whose foot? In Yeshua's step. He not stepping in his own step, but he's stepping in the step that was made for him. But you, no one can make you step there. No one can actually take you and put you there. You must step there. So now we see that this historical book, it's historically proven. So now it's indisputable. It's indisputable. Some of the most critical scholars in to date, Bart Ehrman and all these real thinkers who actually take a fine, you know, we say it, a fine tooth comb and go through the evidence to see if this is historically, presented, and from a historical approach, this scripture is what it says it is from a historical perspective. Yeah, it's undeniable. The only thing that is not conclusive, who could tell me? The man of Yahshua HaMashiach. It's not that they're not saying he didn't live or exist. They're not saying that. All they're saying is that the historical document doesn't show him claiming what he had claimed. And it's not that historically he didn't exist. He did exist. And we know Josephus, and what's your controversial analysis on Josephus and his writing and what have you. But when you look at how the authors at that particular point in time, how they wrote in reference to just the events that were going on then, because when they write and people read is what they know, is what they have been what exposed to and with. And remember, you're dealing with a very oral culture and community. So now they had recollection of all that which took place. Most people that say, these scholars and they today, they say, these people were so dumb, they couldn't write and what have you. And that, again, when you look at history and when you look at the Hebraic text, what I tell you, it is not true. Because when you look at how they write, it's not like how we write today. We don't write in those ways. How we write? We write with words that don't have any meaning. We write, and these words are constructed with what? With one set of letters that are joined to make a word, and this word has no meaning. Each Hebrew letter have a what?
Name.
A what?
Sound.
A sound, a number, a shape, a picture, a meaning, and the code of first mention. And when we do an analysis of what Yahshua is literally saying to his followers, follow me. Follow me comes from what? Trust and what? Relationship. But you could only have a relationship with that which you know. And to know something, to be truthful to something or someone, you must have information and you must know them. How did Simon and Peter and Andrew, well, Simon Peter, Andrew and these brothers, why were they able to just follow me? Because it's translated into Greek. Remember that the Hebrew, the writers then, because it was a Greco-Roman culture and everything, that particular point in time in history, that first century, the language was what? Koine Greek, which was common Greek. And that was the language of the culture. So every documentation that they had, they wrote it in Greek or Aramaic. For the least. However, the Jews, what they would have written it in?
In Hebrew.
However, we don't have any, what? We don't have any sort of fragment from that particular point in time in history saying that they wrote in Hebrew. But what we can do based upon looking at the Greek text, we can reconstruct what was said in Hebrew, because when you look at the Greek, it's a Hebrew pond, and the way the flow of the Hebrew writing is very what? Hebraic. And as you read Hebrew and you read, you will see Greek don't really take on that type of Hebraic pond, how they use words and they use these sort of patterns in their writing. But the Hebrew in itself, it is clear and consistent in what it is communicating. However, when we look at that word, devok, hear the word, devok, and that's the Hebrew word for what? Follow me. Where is the first time we're going to see that word mentioned in scripture? Where is the first time we're going to see that word mentioned in scripture? When we go into Genesis and we look at, if somebody could find it for me, we look at Genesis in the second chapter, and Adam, when he saw his wife, he said, now this is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh, and a man shall leave his mother and father and what?
Be joined to his wife.
And what the King James have? I don't think you'll have any King James here. What do you have there? Right? It have cleave. Right? Cleave. And that word cleave or join to or to become one with. So now you see when Yeshua say devak. Now every Hebrew young lad had the expectation of hearing what? Devak. From who? A rabbi. A rabbi with what? Smika. And a rabbi with smika is him now who institute his laws and his teaching for all his talmidim, his disciples to do what? To follow. Why? Because each rabbi with smika